Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct privilege to introduce one of our distinguished keynote speakers. He has worked with the Center of Disease Control and Prevention for 16 years, served overseas in Russia, Kosovo, and Bangladesh. He has a wide array of experiences, including working with the Food and Drug Administration and the Office of Center Counterterrorism Policy and Planning. He is a strong proponent for youth involvement and a dear friend of HOSA. He played major supporting roles in establishing partnerships with the Office of the Surgeon General and the Medical Reserve Corps. In 2010, he was named the Deputy Surgeon General and went on to serve as the 2013-2014 United States Surgeon General. So without further ado, please help me welcome Rear Admiral Boris Lushniak. Thank you. Sorry if I messed that name up.
Great job. Thank you so much for that kind introduction. It's always interesting for me to be in the position where you hear a little bit about yourself. And get used to it, because HOSA is an organization where you have that opportunity to begin unfolding those chapters of your life that ultimately point you towards a direction. So why are you all here? Tell me, why are you here?
Because we want to be future health professionals and become better leaders.
Okay, and notice there's two key words I pick up. When she said that, this was not prompted, we didn't meet each other ahead of time, we didn't say feed those lines. There's two key components to all of this. One was the word future. So you are building towards something. And the other, which is just as important, is the concept of leaders. You know, in the world of health professionals, what we really need to better our nation are not just people looking for a job. You know, people who look for a job do so for what reason? They do it for perhaps money. They do it perhaps for lifestyle. They do it perhaps for impressing mom and dad or others around us. But ultimately, what I'm looking for, what's going to really change our nation, is this next generation. And the next generation is going to have a whole lot of burdens on their shoulders when it comes to health care in this country. And so this idea that we here within this HOSA community, be you a member of HOSA at the high school level, be you an advisor, a senior person here who is assisting those future health leaders, most important concept here is we need to have growth. We need to be able to push ourselves forward to change our nation for the better. Now, I will congratulate you, right? You're here at a leadership conference here in Washington, D.C. Realize you had a twilight tour last night. Was it fun?
Yes.
Was it beautiful?
Yes.
Did it cause you to have goosebumps and perhaps tears in your eyes when you realize you're in our nation's capital? And that you're here wearing a symbol. Much like I have a uniform and been proudly wearing this uniform for 27 years, not this same uniform, it goes to the dry cleaners occasionally, and over those 27 years it has changed in size a little bit. Rankings have changed. But you also are here in uniform, right? You got your blazers. And what does that blazer symbolize to you?
I don't know. It symbolizes to me leadership. It symbolizes a passion for the health professions, the health professions field. You know,
great. And notice you have the markings. People can spot you. And you also have a concept here. And am I messing you up, Mr. Videographer? You're fine. Okay. Because I'm not a podium guy, as you can tell. Terrible allergic reaction sitting at the podium. You don't want to see it. It's just. But the concept of a uniform, right? The word uni, right? Different words, unicycle, one wheel, uniform, one way of appearing. Now, I realize that you, by wearing the uniform you're wearing, although you are all individuals with individual qualities and characteristics and styles and individual aspirations, But by being here together, wearing that uniform, you symbolize, again, the concept of future and the concept of leadership. And so therefore, you are to be congratulated for what you've done to this point in time. But guess what? The route has only now just begun. You are on a pathway that you've already selected yourself, saying, I'm interested in a certain field, I'm interested in leadership, I'm interested in an organization of which I can become part of the uniform concept. But ahead of you, there's a lot of work to be done. The pathway to the healthcare professions is not an easy pathway. There will be many different barriers thrown in your pathway. I wish I can tell you it's as easy as pie. I wish I can tell you that it's just going to happen. First and foremost, that's not the true answer. Second concept to all this is what? You gotta study hard, right? Nothing is going to happen without hitting the books, without putting in that time and effort to be able to ultimately say, I am achieving something. I am putting knowledge up here. Book knowledge, however, is not enough. We talked about the concept of leadership. And one can learn a little bit about leadership from books. But in essence, you become a leader by doing. By taking those obligations, by taking that pressure upon your shoulders so that you, in essence, experience the concept of leadership. Now, first and foremost, in leadership, to be a good leader, you have to understand what it means to be a good follower. Nothing happens without understanding the concept of followership. No one is born a leader overnight. You learn a lot about leading from observing others. You observe others who are excellent leaders, and guess what? 27 years in government service, I have learned perhaps even more from those who are lousy leaders. Be observant as you go down the pathway of leadership. Be a saturation point of information. Be that sponge that looks around at others and says, what qualities can I learn from individuals? Both good qualities to emulate, to follow, but what bad qualities exist out there that I realize I don't want to go down that certain pathway? So we're talking about the brains part of this. You gotta study hard. The leadership part of this. And then there's the more ethereal spirit part of this, perhaps the soul part of this, which goes back to where we started a few minutes ago, which is what is the motivation, right? It goes beyond here. Oh, I know, you know, they've been taking calculus. I have my chemistry. I got this and that. Oh, I have the great grades, etc. That's not enough. The leadership is the concept of saying, well, come on, we have a mission. We have a goal. Follow me. Let's work together. I've learned to be a follower. I've learned to be a teammate. I am now willing to take those obligations of leadership. But the third component is the most difficult component to speak about. And that's what's in here, right? What are you motivated by? Where is that spirit? Where is that soul? Where is that priming pump that heads you in that right direction? So those three components are critical. And certainly a group like HOSA, I think, begins to fill in many of those gaps. HOSA is not going to be studying for you, right? You have to do it on your own.
Right.
What's your favorite subject?
Biology.
Biology, good. So you spend time, you have a passion perhaps for that subject matter, you like it. But by being a HOSA member, they're not going to study for you. But where HOSA helps in that uniform concept, in the realm of leadership, doing what you're doing. Could you imagine, what grade are you in right now?
I'm a senior.
senior in high school, right? And in the next few days, you have an opportunity to meet with your Congress people, right? With your representatives, right? Are you thrilled about that?
Yes.
So it's amazing to think that at this stage of your life, right, through this affiliation, you are going to do something that's such a small, minuscule number of your peers have actually experienced. You're in Washington, D.C., and you're going to be talking with congressmen and congresswomen about the issues that are important to you. The other aspect, by having this uniform concept, gathering together, wearing the same blazer, there's a unity of spirit here. And that's where it gets into that spirit and soul concept. You know, by wearing the uniform, the U.S. Public Health Service Commission Corps, that's what I'm wearing right now, that's what Captain Tassato there is wearing, he and I are bound together, not just by the fact that we are public health officers, but we are bound together through this spirit, through that soul, a soul that's been in existence for over 200 years of predecessors who have worn this uniform. With the mission, a bold and noble mission of protecting, promoting, and advancing the health and safety of our nation. That's our spirit. Rob and I happen to be good friends as well. Rob and I happen to have been teammates in these last few years. And this is a real shout out to Rob and his whole group at the Medical Reserve Corps that over these last years, 5 years that I've been as Deputy Surgeon General, year and a half as the Acting Surgeon General, where the Medical Reserve Corps has played a key partnership component, originally as a part of the Office of the Surgeon General and intertwining us with HOSA. I'd like everyone to acknowledge Rob's role in all this and give him a shout out. So when we talk about this uniform, mentioned over a quarter of a century in this uniform, and guess what, folks? 2 more weeks, and I'm done with this uniform. I'm retiring out, going on to new challenges. It doesn't quite end, because in the concept of the Commission Corps of the U.S. Public Health Service, the concept of retirement doesn't really exist. Yes, we get papers. It tells us we're no longer on active duty. It tells us we no longer have to wear the uniform on a daily basis. But in essence, is in our frame of mind, because of what? Because of that dedication, because of that spirit, because of that teammanship, all I'm doing is I'm awaiting further orders. In fact, I'm at a retirement ceremony a few weeks ago. The young officers put together a commemorative t-shirt. And it said, Rear Admiral Boris Lushniak, retirement ceremony, awaiting further orders. Because much like within the world of HOSA, much like within the world of healthcare professionals, if this is truly a calling, it never really ends. It's always there. So why am I blessed? I'm blessed because I've had a 27-year career as a Public Health Service Commission Corps officer. You heard part of the story, right? Trained as a medical physician, completed a residency in family medicine to start with, got my master's in public health, got me into that world of looking not only as the individual connectivity with a patient, but looking, as public health people do, at that connectivity with populations. Got in as a young officer back in 1988, started with two little stripes on my shoulders, a young lieutenant. Somehow through luck, perhaps through good work, perhaps right place, right time, end up with 2 stars on my shoulders. It goes from 2 to 2. Had further training later on in dermatology and then in preventive medicine, occupational medicine. Spent 16 years at the CDC, saw the world. Much like our sister services, the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marine Corps, the Coast Guard, the armed services, they go out to defend our country with weapons. We're an unarmed service. Our weapons are what? Our stethoscopes, Our weapons are vaccinations. Our weapons are computers to be able to look at health issues across the land. Served 6 years within the Food and Drug Administration in the realm of counterterrorism, then moved over to the Office of the Surgeon General. I'm blessed because at the end of all this, as I always tell our young officers, life is not about the money that you have. We all want to be comfortable. Nobody wants to be uncomfortable. Earning a living is important. Maybe that's part of your, it's okay if it's part of your motivation for being here. But ultimately, that's not what it's all about. As I tell our young officers, in my viewpoint, life is about the ability to tell stories. It's about the ability to have chapters that allow you to say, you know, I learned something, I progressed, I've met interesting people, I've done interesting things. That's what it's about. It's storytelling. And ladies and gentlemen, I've been blessed with 27 years of storytelling as part of a uniformed service of the United States. And at the end, in these last 2 weeks, October 1st, I wake up that morning no longer an active duty person and no longer the Deputy Surgeon General of the United States. And it's okay. Because all these things, the rank that I wear on my shoulders, the medals that I have on my chest, the titles that come with all these positions, they are but temporary. Your blazers, to a large extent, can be considered temporary. They're important. But what they are is a building pattern. So the rank goes away on October 1st. But the building that went on to attaining that rank, the building that goes on to being a member of HOSA continues. And that's where you leave your influences in the future. The story that unfolded before becomes the story that begins a new chapter in the future. So on September 3rd, I had this great retirement ceremony. I really didn't want a retirement ceremony, but it was a fun event organized by my fellow officers. It made me feel good. 2 days later, I get on an airplane and I fly off to the Sierra Mountains of California. And something that Captain DeSoto and I have in common is love of the outdoors. Love of adventure, love of perhaps doing crazy things. So let me tell you what I learned on this trip, and how it applies to you and your career path. So a team of four of us are in the Sierras. Last year we had eight, team of eight. Most of them were officers, fellow officers. We did this hardcore trip, carrying our backpacks, going through. That was reminiscent of a trip we took 3-4 years ago, team of eight that climbed Mount Rainier. So you can see I have this love of mountains and this love of getting to altitude. And as I was thinking about this meeting in the mountain, you know, the beauty of being in the mountains, you're there with three buddies of yours, you're wearing a very heavy backpack. There's no connectivity with the outside world. The BlackBerry, the smartphone doesn't work. You have a lot of opportunity for introspection, a lot of silence, a lot of grunting. Yes, occasionally a little bit of cussing because that backpack gets heavier and heavier each step you take and the altitude gets to you. But it allows you to think things through. One day in particular, we had established a base camp on this beautiful lake. One guy wanted to take a rest and do some fishing, and three of us looked up and we saw a mountain peak. Shepherd's Peak, it's called. A little over 12,000 feet high, and we're roughly 9,000 feet. We're going to travel light. But when you looked at this mountain, at this peak, and it had a very distinct peak, because part of the reason it was called Shepherd's Mountain was that it had two horns at the top of this peak. And so as you were down at this camp looking up, and you kind of looked and said initially, oh my gosh, it's impossible to get up there. Rob, you've been there before. You've looked at things and said, oh my goodness, that's going to take a lot of effort. And yet the journey begins with what? With that first step out of your base camp. And the first steps could be somewhat easy, right? You're perhaps walking horizontally for a while, and then maybe there's a little bit of elevation, and then maybe things get a little harder. As I reflected on the experiences I was going through that day, as we're climbing this mountain, the worst thing possible was to do two things. Worst thing possible was to keep looking ahead at your goal saying, oh my goodness, we've been at this for 2 hours and it doesn't seem we're getting much closer. The other worst thing was to look behind you and say, oh my God, we're actually advancing, but it looks pretty scary when you're looking downhill. And what I realized at that point in time, and the way it ties into where you're at in your career paths right now, is that you're taking those first steps, in my view, out of the base camp. You have those goals to be a health professional, right? You have those two horns or sticking up, that's something that is out there that you would like to grasp. And yet what I've reflected on, as we're now gaining elevation and the world is becoming much more vertical, so now it's hand over hand and not extreme enough to have to use ropes, but this is bouldering and climbing and getting higher, is that the most important thing to remember is don't get blown away by those two horns sticking up there. Because they may not look much closer, but what you concentrate are the 20 feet around you. What am I doing at this part of the mountain? Don't spend time too much reflecting down because you'll get a little vertigo. Don't look too far ahead because you're going to get overwhelmed. But look at the 10 feet around you, the 20 feet around you, and that's your existence. Because once you look at a career path and you say, okay, here's where I need to be. This is the here and now. And what I need to be doing is I'm going to move to the left because I see a handhold up here. And there's a good place to put my boot into the place. And I can lift myself up. And then you begin the next 10 or 20 feet of your life. But also in that pathway, and we did this multiple times, is occasionally you lift yourself up and you say, you know what? This doesn't seem to be the way to go. Let's back up. Backing up is okay. Let's back up a little bit. Let's reanalyze. Where am I going? What are my career aspirations? What do I need to be doing? So realize that this sort of metaphor of climbing a mountain is where you're at right now. Don't get overwhelmed by looking at the end goal. No one climbs Mount Everest by looking at the top from the beginning. You can have your blinks up there saying, well, listen, you know, this is where I'm still heading. You have to be able to reanalyze what your goals are. But keep concentrating at this stage of your lives at the 10, 20 feet around you. What am I doing? Where am I going? Is it safe? Now, life is filled with risk, and risk-taking is one thing that's an important concept to realize. Right? To be able to partake in risk-taking is important. Nothing comes easy without taking those risks. If you fail, what did I learn from that? You don't give up. You back down. You reanalyze. The other reason I'm blessed is after I got back from the Sierras, in my last three, and this may be my last speech in uniform, Rob, so thank you for arranging this for me and for the HOSA team for accepting this. But my last three speeches were all about the future. So Friday morning, after my vacation, I put on the uniform again, and I went to speak with our officer basic course graduation officers. And these are officers who are newly minted as Commissioned Corps officers in the U.S. Public Health Service. They have just finished a two-week, rather rigorous officer basic course, and they are now beginning their first steps out of base camp, heading towards a different mountain to be an officer in the U.S. Public Health Service. And what an honor as the Deputy Surgeon General to say, okay, I'm in my last three speeches, and it's no longer about the past, it's about the future. Because as the retiring or as the officer who's soon to be awaiting orders, the beauty is I can look at the eyes of the 32 individuals who are graduating on Friday and say, yeah, this is the future. These are the future officers. These are the future leaders. So I feel content knowing nothing lasts forever, that I will pass the baton to one of these young officers and they will take the new duties upon themselves. Friday afternoon, T-minus two speeches. I was at the Uniformed Services University for the Health Sciences. This is the veritable West Point of medical schools. This is the medical school that's run by the services. The Army, the Navy, the Air Force, and the Public Health Service have officers in this medical school. And it was their convocation on Friday afternoon. So it was all the brand new students, the first years, all lined up in their brand new uniforms. And this is, once again, the future of medicine, of uniform service medicine. And now, perhaps the biggest treat of all, to think that this, as my last speech as Deputy Surgeon General of the United States, even takes it back one step earlier in the process. To be able to sit here, stand here, and speak with high school students and their mentors and their leadership, and to say to them, remember why you're here. Remember the concepts of leadership, of passion towards a profession, of studying hard, of the spirit and soul. And I walk away content. Looking in your eyes, I realize we're in good hands. And I mentioned the concept that we have lots of things to do to better our nation. And it's going to be in your hands. You know, one of the big pushing things that we pushed on from the beginning in the Office of the Surgeon General is the concept of prevention of diseases. You know, in this nation, we've gotten great at diagnosing diseases. We've gotten great at treating diseases. You know, in my lifetime, we've developed incredible pharmaceutical agents, drugs that take care of problems. We've developed incredible surgical techniques. You have your arteries and your heart clogged up? We can ream those out. We've developed incredible devices we can implant into people. And yet you realize that at the end of the day, all that is treating a problem that in most circumstances would have been preventable. You know, the concept of diabetes in this country as an example, most cases preventable, associated with the overweight and obesity problem, with the lack of exercise, with people not taking care of themselves. 51 years now after the release of the first Surgeon General's report on smoking and health, I was honored to be the lead in releasing the 50th anniversary report. And the beauty of that report said since 1964 to 2014, we've done incredible things, but not incredible enough. When you realize that each and every year, 480,000 Americans die from smoking-related diseases, 500,000 people. These are preventable diseases. The concept of how we take care of ourselves. Are we eating the right things? Are we exercising? In the last few weeks, the Surgeon General released a new call to action on walking in walkable communities, realizing that something as simple as us walking again as a nation, of moving around, of putting in that effort, right, of stretching a little bit, is not only good for the body, but it's good for the mind, the psychological benefits of exercises out there. So these are but part of the pathways that exist, and why this last talk for me is so important. Because I strongly believe that your generation is going to be the generation that takes on that spirit, that takes on that leadership, that takes on that book learning and heads us in a totally different direction. That this will be the generation that will eliminate smoking in our society. That someday we'll look at it and say, how bizarre that we used to put these things in our mouths and smoke them, at the same time killing ourselves. That this generation will take on that leadership to realize that we are responsible for our bodies, and the body is a sacred temple that needs to be taken care of. That this generation will determine the right ways of communicating with society. Now, my generation's first language is not Twitter. It's not Facebook. It's not the internet. We're learning that as a second language. Your generation, it's your primary language. Utilize that fluency to be able to push us to a new way of communicating on health issues with our society. That's the burden that falls upon your shoulders. So in conclusion, it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be here as my last speech as Deputy Surgeon General. I walk away looking for those new challenges in my life, but realizing that I'm at ease. Because looking once again in your eyes, feeling the spirit in this room, allows me to realize that we are going to be heading in a better direction in this nation. So thank you so much for your attention, and welcome to Washington, D.C.
Would you like to take some questions?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Dr. Lushniak, for being the living embodiment and of the journey, ideals, and health professional that we all aspire to become. And thank you for letting us be your last audience as Deputy Surgeon General and entrusting the future of health to us. Dr. Lushniak, everybody. Dr. Lushniak will be taking any questions as of now, so if you'd like to raise your hand and if you have anything that you'd like to ask Dr. Lushniak while he's here, now would be the time to do so.
I say for that speech, he deserves a weak hairpin. Don't y'all agree?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do we have any questions?
We got one over there. Oh, come on, anything goes. We can be real informal here.
I heard earlier that you talked that you were in family medicine. How did you transition from that to the career that you're in now?
That's a great question. So the question is in terms of transitions from family medicine. So, you know, I think a quintessential change in my career path, you know, when I went into medical school, I was the first person in my family in the field of medicine. So I'm the son of immigrants to this country. My parents came from Ukraine post-World War II. The war, as you know, ended in 1945. My parents spent 4 years in displaced persons camps as refugees in Germany waiting for a way out, and ultimately were able to come to the United States. I was born a decade later in 1959, but my parents were immigrants. You know, Ukrainian was the language spoken in our household. That was my first language. My father was a laborer. He worked in a factory in Chicago. My mother also worked in the factory, then worked in the bank. But, you know, one thing that they taught us from the beginning was the importance of two things, one of which was the importance of getting a good education, and they spent a lot of their effort pointing us in that direction. And the second was the realization that we, in the United States, live in the land of opportunity, that a lot of it depends on us, right? So when I entered medical school, I had no idea what I was getting myself into. I really didn't, because, you know, all I had was the role models of those around me, and it just happened to be a doc who worked in the Ukrainian neighborhood in Chicago. He happened to be a Ukrainian-American as well, or a immigrant. His name was Dr. Lepichak, and he was my role model. And he was a family doc, and that's what I wanted to begin studies in. And I love family medicine. You know, it's the whole concept of you know, from cradle to grave, as we used to call it. You know, you take care of the whole person, and you take care of all things in that whole person. You aren't a super specialist in any arena. But I think the major change for me was when I got my master's in public health, and that occurred right after medical school, before I started my residency. And it gave me a perspective that not only is there satisfaction, as I mentioned, in that one-on-one doctor-patient relationship, and I still continue to see patients in dermatology, for example, until the last few years, but there really was almost this bigger issue, and the bigger issue is the population approach, right? So if I have a person with hypertension, I can touch that individual by, you know, by making sure they're eating the right things, to make sure that they try to lose weight, to make sure that they're on the medications as necessary. But I found almost a greater satisfaction of dealing with that hypertensive concept in the population. How can I change society? Now, mind you, it's sometimes as difficult, if not more difficult, right? The one-on-one, you come back next week, I check you again. How do you monitor society? How do you point us in the right direction? It's certainly a lot more frustrating, because change from a societal viewpoint takes a long time. So, you know, I still see myself as a family physician, because that's where I started. And I think having that general training at the beginning of my life really pointed me to looking at the whole body and not being a super specialist. But then I became a super specialist, so it's sort of the combination of things. Thanks, good question.
What was it going through med school and everything that really drove you to get where you are today?
So the issue of drive, you know, I go back to my parents, right? The concept in our family was anything is attainable. When I found out about the U.S. Public Health Service Commission Corps, when I realized that, you know, very few people know about us, we're only 6,700 officers, we don't have TV shows about us, we don't, you know, have major advertisements, we don't sponsor a NASCAR car. But, you know, when I found out about the service, it sort of combined things, you know, in terms of drive. Because what it combined things was my payback to this nation. And it's not a personal payback. You know, I had college loans and medical school loans that I paid back monetarily. It was what this nation did on Labor Day 1949, accepting two young people, my parents, into this country and turning them into staunch patriotic Americans who realized that this was a life changer for them. So the drive really was, how do I give back to be able to thank this country for what it gave my family and it gave me. You know, when you talk about drive, drive is really, once again, it's that whole sense of how we view our lives. I mentioned the concept of storytelling. You can't tell a story unless you take risks. You know, the key feature with sort of advancing in any profession is the ability to start answering simple questions. And the simple question is, it's not about comfort, folks. I mentioned the sort of the monetary things, right? If you're comfortable in what you're doing and in a profession, if you're comfortable, oh, you know, nothing's riling me, I'm just, then the question can be, are you really living, right? If it's just so comfortable, it's okay, fine. And I'm not saying that that needs to be your approach, it's my approach. And my approach has always been, the minute I started getting comfortable in something, then I was seeking another challenge, right? The minute that it became routine, I sought another challenge. You know, my advice to you is, no matter what you're doing, and it's sort of set up in our educational system already. You know, I tell my young officers, I go, between every 3 to 5 years, reanalyze where you're heading and what you're doing. It fits into our educational system because why? Because you're in high school. You know, that's a 4-year term. You're different as seniors than you were as freshmen. You've learned a lot more. You've primed yourself. Now you enter a next phase. Many of you will go to universities. That's another 4-year term. And at the end of that term, you also reanalyze. And I believe you need to do that throughout your life, right? Every 3 to 5 years, you kind of say, A, it's not necessarily, it's part of it is happiness. Am I happy what I'm doing? And part of it is comfort, you know? If I'm too comfortable, then maybe I'm not doing something that should be challenging me, that should be teaching me. You should be learning from everything that you do. So oddly enough, this November is my 5th anniversary of stepping in as the Deputy Surgeon General. How odd that I'm making a transition, right, to something brand new. Am I scared? Let's talk about fear for a second as a motivating factor. You know, there's been plenty of times that I've been scared. Right? Only the foolish don't acknowledge fear. Now, I'll tell you, multiple times in my career path, 5 years ago when the Surgeon General of the United States gave me a call saying, I want you to be my Deputy Surgeon General, my initial reaction was, I'm hiding in the corner because I don't want those responsibilities. It's going to be too tough a job. I'm not sure if I can succeed. That's my initial reaction. And yet the major feature when it comes to motivation and fear is acknowledge fear. Fear exists on that mountain. Do I get scared? Rob, do you get scared rock climbing? Yeah. I mean, it happens all the time where you kind of say, whoa. But the big feature, both in the career path and on the side of a mountain, is what? Acknowledge fear, deal with it, don't let fear paralyze you. You know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, your pathway is not an easy pathway. If you're dedicated to joining the healthcare professions, you have a lot of work ahead of you. If it scares you, then you gotta choose something else. Acknowledge that this is gonna be a tough course. Acknowledge there's gonna be tough decisions to be made, right? But fear as a motivator, a key component. Don't let it paralyze you. Yes. Why don't you use the microphone in that?
Hi, my name is Raj. I'm from Delaware HOSA. What tips would you provide for students aspiring to go to medical school and picking a specialty?
What was your first part of the question? What?
Tips. Yeah, what tips and specialty?
So first thing regarding tips, you know, it goes back to the whole idea. You're not going to get anywhere without having decent scholastics, extraordinary scholastics. My tip is put your nose to the grindstone and study. So my daughter, 3-4 weeks ago, I dropped off my oldest daughter in college. So first year student, she has aspirations of entering the medical field. And you know, I talked to her yesterday, and it's funny because she's a great student, right? She worked hard throughout high school. And there was always this fantasy as if, oh, I'll work really hard in high school, and then because I'll be such a good student and because I'll know how to study and all that, that somehow college will be easy. I asked her yesterday a simple question. I said, so her name is Larissa. I go, Larissa, have you been to the football game yet? And she's at a Division III school. She's at Washington University in St. Louis. So this sports isn't big there. And her response to me was, you know, a few of my friends went to a football game a few weeks ago, but I don't know. I'm not sure how people who go, and I'm not dissing big name sports schools. I'm just saying this is one kid's perspective. How kids go to big name sports school, because on Saturdays, I don't have time to go to a football game because I'm studying. And it's interesting because that, in essence, is reflection of what the work you need to be doing, right? I mean, she intertwines it with working out. She intertwines it with going to concerts. She has friends. You know, I'm not talking that it's, but first, the major tip for you, you know, if you're interested in medical school, is no medical school is going to begin looking at you unless, right, you've done well scholastically. So do that. The other thing that medical schools look at is the concept of, you know, which is all entwined in the world of HOSA. Leadership, Are you a proven leader? Have you taken on those risks of leadership? Have you taken on those burdens? Right. The third component is service to others. So realize that you're going to be in any healthcare profession, whether it's medical school, nursing school, dental school, pharmacy school, you're going to be serving others. And so the professional schools really want to show or see from you that service is part of what you're about. So those things are all checkoff things. You can be a good student, right? You can study hard, you can get great GPAs. You can do the leadership stuff, you know, you can get through it saying, oh, I was doing this, I was doing that. The service component, we can all put in our service hours and do it all that. The fourth part, which is, goes back to what I had mentioned earlier about this ethereal concept, is, you know what the schools are looking for? Passion. Passion. They want you to be filled with that love of this profession. They want to see the exuberance in you. And that you can't fake, right? You either have it or not. And if you don't have it now, figure out how you're going to get it, or you don't belong. Passion is key. In terms of the professions, you know, in terms of medical school and saying, well, what specialty do I want to be? You know, I always say, never force the issue. Give it time, right? Goes back to that mountain metaphor, the analogy there. It's 10 feet at a time. Get your handholds. At some point in the process, I think the mistake is going in with preconceived notions, and I'm sorry those of you who want to be plastic surgeons or whatever already. Fine, keep that on your list, but never block yourself out. You know, did this guy named Lushniak ever envision when he was sitting in, you know, in laboratories at Northwestern Medical School as a student that he would someday be the acting Surgeon General of the United States? Absolutely not. Never envisioned it. If I had blocked myself in saying this is all I want to do, then you don't look at opportunities that are out there. Great question. Yes. And HOSA leadership, let me know when we're finished. I'm here all day, so I have no problem. I don't really have a job anymore, as you know.
Given your position, you've had a very unique perspective on this. So I was wondering, where do you see the future of health in the United States and healthcare in the United States going in the next 10 to 20 years?
Great question. So part of it, as you know, we've kind of been living through the struggles of healthcare financing, right? The Affordable Care Act, its law. My sense is that I'm a supporter of that act. And part of it is the simple numbers that we saw recently released in the news this week, which is the number of uninsured and underinsured has fallen. You know, what a travesty to be the richest nation on this planet and not be able to provide health care to its citizens, right? One can argue, is health care a right or is it a privilege? And my viewpoint is it's a right, right? That we have to have that and be able to support our citizens. No matter where you stand politically, yes, there are things that can be tweaked, but the next 10 years is that opportunity to tweak the health care financing part of this. So we're going to have to get better at that. There's still a lot of unresolved issues, but I think we're heading in the right direction. Two other components. One is very controversial because a lot of physicians are up in arms about all this right now, and that's the issue of, you know, the electronic health record. So how do we turn from my generation's viewpoint? I mentioned, you know, my first language, you know, I used to think that people who use Twitter are called twits because that's what my kids called me. Dad, you're a twit. I thought, oh, that's great. That must be a compliment. But it's that sense that, you know, I go from a society where, you know, we did all the medical records by hand. And then there was an innovation. Then we started using a dictation machine. And I would do history and physical. This is a 36-year-old white male who comes in complaining of da-da-da-da-da. And then somehow, magically, in a few days, a transcript would come back. And what we're finding, and this is going to be in your hands to a large extent, is the next 10 years is how do we make sure that that transition goes well? Because what we have is we have an incredible information technology that needs those records to be put in the format that I can take my medical record and move to Anchorage, Alaska, and that doctor, that healthcare system will understand who I am without starting things all over again. It's a money saving, cost savings measure, yes, but it's an efficiency measure. And from a public health perspective, it's incredibly important information that we can find out about the health of our nation. Third component of changes, I think the team approach is happening more and more. We're talking about the concept of a medical home, for example, where every person plays a role, right? The concept of the doctor, the MD or the DO being the team captain, I think it's a thing of the past. I think we have to have many responsibilities thrown in, and that includes sort of the team approach, right? Where is the role of the nutritionist in this, the dietitian in this? Where is the role of the person who's advising people on exercise, right? Where's the psychologist, the behavioral scientist in all this? The reality is that if we are really going to look at health as defined by the World Health Organization, and I want you to listen to this, I'm actually going to ask you to close your eyes. Because if you're thinking about the health professions, you have to hear this definition. This is the definition of health. I'm going to say it very slowly, and you concentrate on each of the words. Health is the complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. Open up your eyes. You realize so many years we've struggled with the concept of health being, okay, when you're sick, I'll write you a prescription. When I need an operation, I'll cut on you. When I need to put in a device, I'll do that. The 21st century brings us the challenges of fulfilling that definition. Complete physical, mental, and social well-being. So one can argue, you know, where we've dropped the ball. Is poverty a health issue? Yeah. But we've not tackled it as a health issue. It's time we do. You know, so many of our world problems are associated and affect people's health. And I think the next 10 to 15 years, we have to reanalyze it. How are we really looking at the all-encompassing definition of health and not merely saying, oh, you're hypertensive? Look, take a pill. Thanks. Good question.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Sarah Fleischman from Florida HOSA. And firstly, I would like to thank you for your service. And my second question will be, how has traveling to other countries impacted your career as a health professional?
Great. The whole concept of, you know, the world being a small place. So, you know, we now term this all issues of global health. And I think that was an extremely important part of why I joined the uniformed service, is to have those opportunities. You know, the world is a small place. What we find is that, you know, health issues no longer are just kept to one city, to one region, to one part of the world. We don't need to look back very much further than the situation with Ebola in Western Africa. You look at that as a global health issue, right? We need to have people who understand global health. I was honored to have been chosen to actually lead our response for 2 months in Liberia. So we ran the Monrovia Medical Unit, a small hospital, the only medical unit run by the US government that actually took care of Ebola patients in Liberia. And for me, those international assignments always were just earth-shaking for me, right? It's that concept of us understanding the world, us understanding other cultures, us understanding the needs of those cultures, and us being able to play a role in that. And ultimately, our mission there is kind of interesting. Why would a uniformed service establish a hospital in Liberia? Right? We're not a Liberian public health service. Part of it is we're there to help the world. But part of it is ultimately is that's how we tackle diseases now in this world, which is, you know, we take the battle to the front where it needs to be battled in order to protect our own nation. So I think global health is a key feature of that. Throughout my career path, I had opportunities to be in Bangladesh and deal with disaster response in Bangladesh. I was in Kosovo during the war to help with internally displaced people, in Russia dealing with the diphtheria epidemic, and multiple other such assignments. Each of those changed me for the better. Thanks. Good.
Thank you. I'm Mike Riley from Florida HOSA. There's a handful of college students in here. Through your entire career of getting an education, what was your favorite and least favorite subject in or everything?
So throughout this whole education, you know, I was more of a bio guy than the chem guy. And you know, I think it's one of those things where maybe you make that, you know, my daughter may break the mold because she likes both. Actually, she likes chem probably even more. But the class I hated the most, physical chemistry. P-Chem. Oh, my God. I did okay with organic, but P-Chem I hated. But the bio courses were really amongst my favorite. And then courses, you know what really intrigued me is when I did my master's in public health, was realizing that there's so much more to the health education concept. I almost walked away from the MPH year that I took, and again, I took it after I got my MD, before I started my residency, almost feeling that medical school is incomplete, that we should probably have a fifth year, I know, grown in medical school, where everybody walks away with a master's in public health, because it's that whole sense of looking at the world differently. You know, it's just not about, you know, the pharmacokinetics of drugs, it's not about the procedures that we do in medicine, but in essence, it gives you a different worldview. And it's okay to hate classes that you have to take. You know, you can't love everything. I mentioned the word passion. You can't be passionate about everything. You know, the passion I'm talking about is the passion for the profession, and not so much that you got to love every single darn class you've taken. Certainly didn't happen for me. And did I do poorly in some classes? Absolutely. So the whole issue it's climbing that mountain, right? You move ahead, there's a blockade. There's no way you're going to get around that blockade without being unsafe. So it's okay to back up occasionally and reanalyze. Good. Are we down to one question? Okay, so one last question, and you're the lucky person. Actually, no, we're going to do two questions because I didn't choose somebody from the back of the room yet.
In terms of leadership, do you have any tips for, like, specifically in your position?
There's two aspects to leadership, as I mentioned earlier. I think you can read about leadership, and I would recommend. There's no particular book on leadership that I think is better than anything else. You can read people's life stories and find out what leaders are all about. Colin Powell came out with a book a few years ago that talks about some of the characteristics of military leadership, which I think is applicable to all aspects of leadership. But I would become a student of leadership. One never stops being a student of leadership. But I'm going to hit you with the four D's that I talk about leadership, and this is what you have to do to be a leader. One is, the first D is decide, make decisions. So no leader is capable of being a leader unless you're willing to make decisions. And how you make decisions is up to you in that leadership position. You can do it as a group, you can do it, you know, there's an old saying that the best way of making a decision is in a committee. And that committee is an odd number of people, but it needs to be less than three. So, the numbers are out there. So, so decide. Leaders need to make decisions. The most inept leaders I've ever seen were leaders who were paralyzed by decision making. Oh, I can't make a decision. It's too hard. Oh, I can't do this because someone's not going to like me. Oh, I can't do this. No. Leadership denotes making decisions. Second part of leadership, it's not always about you. Delegate as a leader, right? You're part of the decision-making thing, but allow others to flourish. Delegate. Find those people who can help you to be able to implement those things, who take responsibility. Important part of leadership, a part of that second D of delegating things, is ultimately the ability for that person to be the next generation of leaders. It's the concept in leadership which is so important and so underutilized of succession planning. They say if you fall into the leadership role, one of your prime objectives, first day on the job, is to determine and begin the process of who's going to take over for you. It's kind of weird. You're starting a brand new job and you're thinking, yeah, that's when it begins. The concept that somebody needs to do it. And that's the third D, which is important. So we have decide, we have delegate, and the third one, which is innately impossible for most people who are in leadership positions, is disappear. Allow the people who you've tasked with doing the work to do their work. The concept of micromanagement gets thrown in here, right? Do I need to be peering over your shoulder all the time, making sure that everything's fine? Again, it's the ability to allow others to flourish. The fourth D is deliver or do. It's still your responsibility to complete whatever you decided. So those are the four D's of leadership that I always tout on. There's a funny story talking about, you know, blaming others in leadership. And, you know, as I think about what I'm going to leave for the next Deputy Surgeon General is the concept of the three envelopes. And the three envelopes, I think, are one of my favorite stories. So the leader who's leaving leaves three envelopes for the leader taking over. And the person gives the instructions and says, okay, when I'm gone and things get really rough, open up these envelopes, but in the order that they're numbered. So number one, number two, and number three. So the leader retires out, new leader takes over, and within a few months, things are really bad for the new leader. Things are horrendous. So the new leader opens up the envelope number one. And it says, blame me. Okay, so that's a tactic, right? So you blame the former leader. Oh, all this is their doing, you know. A few months later, things are just as bad, if not worse. Open up number two and saying, reorganize. Typical tactic, right? Things aren't going bad, reorganize. A few months after that, things are still pretty bad. You open up the third envelope, it says, prepare three envelopes. Realize that there's risk-taking in being in leadership positions. None of these positions last forever. There are people in leadership positions who are above you. You know, you're never the ultimate dictator here. And so you are going to be under scrutiny. That's part of the risk of being in leadership positions. Okay, we have one last question here. And it's a lot of responsibility because this has got to be one doozer of a question.
I don't know. How did you separate yourself emotionally from patients that did not survive or were fatally ill?
You know, you don't need to separate yourself emotionally. You know, crying is okay if you're sad. You know, there's nothing that we in the healthcare professions somehow that magically allows us to be rocks and rock solid. You know, there's several time periods in my life. I once served at a missionary hospital on the island of St. Lucia, a place called St. Jude Hospital in the southern part of St. Lucia called Vieux-Fort. And I was the on-call pediatric ER doc one night. And a little kid walked in that I had seen that afternoon in clinic. We had diagnosed with worms. We had treated, and the kid came back that night and died in front of me. How did I emotionally separate myself from that event? I didn't. I sobbed like a baby because that was my responsibility. I don't know whether I did something right or I did something wrong. It was inevitable. Now, the reality is you need to develop some sort of barrier, right? So sobbing each and every time or sobbing at every single little thing that's out there is not the right approach. What we have to do is you have to always feel confident in that what you've done was the right thing to do. And when you question whether you've done the right thing to do, then question it, right? But, you know, don't think that you have to be emotional in this line of work. When I was in Liberia, you know, what was fascinating there was I was there with 70 PHS, public health service officers. We had teams of 70 rotating in every 2 months. So I was there for part of team two and part of team three. Both teams saw the successes of treatment. And there's almost a religious experience to some extent as we discharge people. One in particular I remember was a woman who had been in our hospital for 21 days, 3 weeks, was on death's door multiple times from Ebola disease. And our team pulled her out time and time again. A week before she was admitted, her brother, who was also a nurse at one of the Ebola treatment units there, all of them Liberian, had died under our care. When she was there, 2 days after she got admitted, another brother of hers got admitted. The two of them were side by side. He died, she lived. And at the end of all this, each and every person that we had treated successfully, once they had the negative PCRs, proving that they no longer had the disease, we would see them off. And it was almost a religious ritual. They would come, our nurses would take them aside. They would change their clothing, bring them fresh clothing. They would shower, almost a baptismal thing, right? Then they would come out, and in this case, they came out to a family that was joyous, that was outside our gates, singing songs, welcoming her back. All 70 of the officers are out there. There were tears of joy. And our ritual at our Monrovia Medical Unit was at the end of your time, when you got discharged successfully, we had a big board called the Survivor's Board. The person would put on a glove, would put their hand into yellow paint. The board was painted blue. They would leave their handprint on the wall and sign it. And because our mission there was to treat healthcare providers, we didn't treat general population. We treated those who were taking care of others. The motto on this wall said, I am healed today so I can heal others tomorrow. This is the healthcare professions taking care of themselves. So that's the emotion of joy. And at the same time, when her brother died earlier that week, those same doctors and nurses and logisticians and communications people sobbed. Because every effort that was given to her was given to him. And it was out of our hands to some extent of who would survive from this terrible disease. It's okay to have emotion in medicine. And on that note, with my last emotion as the Deputy Surgeon General of the United States, probably my last speech, my emotion is one of joy. My emotion is one of confidence in what you, HOSA members, will bring to our nation. And my next stage, the next chapter, the next risk-taking venture, the next scary part begins. So wish me luck, guys.
As a small token of our appreciation for your time here, we'd like to give you a We Care pin on behalf of all the HOSA Great. Members here.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. That's great. Thank you. Great. Keep up the good work, everyone. Good job.
You guys have a 10-minute break.